our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And our first hymn, Christ whose glory fills the skies. Is that right?
Yes. Got it.
Let's stand and sing. We say together, God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We turn unto God that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we have failed to do. For the sake of Jesus, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and we'll sing the Lord.
Thank you.
straight our crooked hearts and bend our wills to love your goodness and your glory in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Do please take a seat and we'll have our first two readings.
Old Testament reading, he's taken from Exodus. The Old Testament reading is taken from Exodus chapter 24, verses 12 to 18. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now, the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain, and Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is taken from the second letter of Peter, chapter 1, verses 16 to 21. "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honour and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased,' we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have something more sure, the prophetic word, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart. Knowing first of all that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God, as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll sing our second hymn, "Jesus Will Take the Highest Honor."
Jesus will take the highest honor. reading comes from Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 to 9. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. Then he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, This is my son, my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, Tell no one of the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Do please be seated. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you are faithful in spite of our weaknesses and our brokenness. Thank you that you are true, that you love us and want us to know and love you. We pray that you would speak to our hearts, our minds and our spirits this morning, that we would encounter you and you would draw us closer to you. Amen. Well, this morning I'm going to look at that extract from the second letter of Peter. And Peter, as I'm sure you will remember, was something of a passionate man. He didn't do anything by halves. And in the verse or so before our passage starts, Peter, passionate as ever, explains why he wrote this particular letter, saying that it was for the benefit of those who would hear and read it after his death. He wanted people to have a reliable record of what he had seen and done, and of the Lord Jesus who he knew, both in the flesh and in the spirit. He wanted people to have a reliable record so they too would know Jesus and would resist false teachers, trusting God's word and his record over men's. Now, were Peter writing this letter today, he'd almost certainly be roundly rebuked for not accepting the sincere conclusions of others who had reached different answers to him. He'd be told that he should seek to disagree well. Well, I think Peter would have replied, I am disagreeing well, but not quite in the way you mean. He proclaimed plainly here that he was right and the false teachers were wrong and so should be rejected. In the opening verse, verse 16, Peter describes what the peddlers of their own interpretations were offering as cleverly devised myths, and this was not a compliment. He had taken, apparently, a term that was used generally about people who spoke and gave ideas and tweaked it slightly for his use. So there's God's word, Peter's witness, which were true, false teachers cleverly devised myths. As I've said, Peter knew Jesus and had been present at a moment of huge privilege and importance, the Transfiguration, which we heard in Matthew's Gospel's reading. Like Matthew, Peter wants us to gain a sense of the power, the glory, the majesty of Jesus, gain a sense of Father God's personal approval of Jesus. This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. And Peter wants us to have a sense of Christ fulfilling biblical prophecy and promise and teaching. That's part of the message that comes from the presence of Moses and Elijah. And Peter, as he describes in this passage, wants Christ's light to light each and every heart of each and every hearer and reader as much as it lit his own. And in his letter he's saying that he doesn't want Christ's light dimmed or snuffed out by clever, misleading teachings. He does not want people to miss out on the wonder and honour, privilege and joy of knowing Jesus. He realised that if it didn't matter whether you followed the false teachers or the word of God, it wouldn't matter whether you did what you wanted or what God wanted. If that was the case, there was little point for Jesus having come in the first place and gone through all that he did, crucifixion and death on the cross and rising again, that we might be forgiven. What would be the point? Well, Peter passionately believed it mattered deeply, and he proclaimed it boldly. Peter had been present and involved during Christ's first coming, when Christ was ministering all over Israel, Judea, Samaria, and various other places as well. He was an eyewitness to Christ's death and his being alive after his resurrection. And he was an eyewitness, as he says here, when Christ's majesty had been revealed. And he now links that revelation, that glory in Christ, to Christ's return in the future in glory and power and might and majesty. Both of these things, Christ's first arrival, the Transfiguration, and his second coming, fulfilling Scripture and revealing its glorious truth, reliability, and authority. Peter was showing us that the Transfiguration, as well as linking to the past, was a view into the future and the exaltation of Jesus in power and glory. So Peter is assuring people of Christ's return while encouraging them, and so us, to live in the light of that and in preparation for it, so that we don't miss out on the great party to come. He assures us that no prophecy in Scripture comes from the interpretations of men, but comes from God through the working of the Holy Spirit, through the writers and the prophets who recorded and made the prophecies. So we can be sure that Jesus will return, and that Scripture's descriptions of it will tie up with those events on the day. Quite how that will be, we possibly may get to hear, see. We may have died before then, who knows? Peter is also pointing out and assuring people that Scripture as a whole is divinely inspired and not humanly made up. So we can trust Scripture, and it makes sense to trust Scripture, but not human interpretations and false teachings. He says in verse 19 that we will do well to pay attention to it, to what Scripture says, as something that brings light to our thinking rather than our thinking bringing some kind of light to it. No matter how sincerely we may believe that our darkness lights God's word. Now, Peter knew how stutteringly the morning star that is Jesus dawns fully in people's lives. He knew Jesus, spent time with him, and yet he knew what it was to deny Jesus and to do so emphatically. He knew also the fullness of how it feels to be forgiven and restored. In his letter, he's showing that he does not want people to be misled into that dark place of denying Jesus, his word and his ways. Maybe not as emphatically as him, but as practically. He prefers people to persevere in faith and trust and live in Christ's warm and healing light. Peter's point was that until the Lord's return, people should give attention to the Old Testament and to the Apostles' teaching. Now, the Apostles' teaching then hadn't been collated as it has been for us. The Apostles' teaching is what we now call the New Testament. So Peter's wanting us, by extension if you like, to pay attention and to take note of the Old Testament and the New, the whole of Scripture. And he's pointing out that the alleged light of the false teachers and their teaching was no light at all. Now, he doesn't go into detail of what that teaching was. There are a couple of ideas that the commentators suggest, but he's approaching the idea of false teaching in quite a broad way. And as one commentator wrote, false teaching flows from the minds of men and women. Truth flows from the heart and mind of the living God. False teaching brings division between the church and between people, the church and God. Peter asks rhetorically, why would we not want to trust Jesus, his word and his ways, and live in the warmth of his love and his light? Why would we prefer men's interpretations and darkness, even if it seems momentarily good? He gives us the choice, effectively saying that it boils down to us choosing to believe and follow God's word, or to believe and follow those who disagree with it. No different then to now. We have the choice. We have the choice to trust what God has said through the Holy Spirit's inspiration of the writers of Scripture, or to trust the interpretations of those who say they sincerely and deeply studied God's word and come to their alternative view. Which is valid, which is true, and which is right? In Matthew's Gospel reading, we have the glory of Christ held up before us when, as we're told, his face shone like the sun and his clothes became white as light, and as a bright cloud overshadowed them, hearing God, Father God, saying, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Are you going to change
that? Oh, yeah.
Aware that I'm getting close to our singing our next hymn, so getting that prepared. So Father God says, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. May we, each and all of us, listen to Peter's passionate exhortation and follow Father God's instruction. May we live in the light of Christ's light, with it shining more brightly in our hearts and lives day by day, so that we together shine Christ's light in our community. That we bring the light of Christ into our world, what the Bible calls our dark world, rather than bringing our dark world into Christ's light, dimming it or even snuffing it out. May we resist and reject the cleverly devised myths promoted by those who disagree with God's words and ways. And I pray that just in the same way that the sun rises each day, so the light of Christ will rise in each of our hearts, shining more and more each day as we faithfully follow his word and his ways. Before our Lord God and ask him to shine his light afresh in our hearts, our minds and our spirits today. Let's ask him to show us where that light is being dulled or maybe even snuffed out. And let's ask him to show us where we are bending our ears and listening to cleverly devised myths, even if they don't seem that. And let's ask him to fill us afresh with the Holy Spirit and trust and confidence in the truth and life-giving warmth of his Holy Word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us stand and we'll say the Nicene Creed together. We believe.
Projector. I blanked it.
Let's say the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, Father the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified and upon his Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Do please sit or kneel, and please pass us all and lead us in our prayers of intercession.
Gracious God, we often feel by the middle of February that winter has gone on long enough. Although this year we have been lucky with the long, dry and warm spell we've been having. Cold and darkness prevail for months, and winter sometimes has a sting in its tail before spring arrives, as it might happen this year if the Met Office is to be believed. But underground, life is beginning to stir as nature hatches new plans like the snowdrops and daffodils that have appeared in our gardens and countryside. We pray that, as nature comes to life, you will be welcome our sleeping faith as well. So warm our hearts and kindle our hope for joys to come. Lord, hear us.
Lord, pray for us.
In February, we have celebrated the Feast of St. Valentine, and declarations of love were made and enjoyed in myriad ways. We give thanks for the irresistible gift of human love, giving delight, companionship and comfort, while praying also for those who feel left outside that experience, neglected and unloved by those who should know better. We pray for all the couples who have been or are going to be married this year in St. Michael's Church, Ledbury, and at Eastmore, that they have long and prosperous lives together. Make us agents of your love to everybody we meet this week. Lord, hear us. In February, our horizons are often closed down as we plod on towards warmer and lighter days. February makes life seem predictable and unexciting. Yet we are citizens of a thrilling and fascinating world. Keep our eyes open and our vision high, both for this world and the next. In this world, we pray for the leaders of the United Kingdom and our well-worn instruments of government. We ask particularly for wisdom for those in international institutions like the United Nations, as they try to help the people of Turkey and Syria nearly 2 weeks after the huge earthquakes that hit that region, which was already poor through famine and war. We give thanks for for all the aid agencies and volunteers who have gone out to the area to help with the recovery of the dead and help with supplying shelter for the living during the cold weather. Pray for all the families who have lost loved ones in the area and give hope to the injured and homeless that they will survive until spring comes to give them new life. We pray for the people who live in the North Island of New Zealand that has been hit by Cyclone Gabrielle last Monday, causing loss of life and considerable damage to property. Lord, hear us. In February, we often experience the ordinariness of life without the highlights of festivals and holidays and summer sun on our backs. February drags by, but we're hopeful that next week brings Lent, so we will be getting nearer to Easter and the glorious resurrection of our Lord. We pray for all those who are sick in mind, body or spirit, those on our pew sheet and those who we know and those who only God knows. We remember in our prayers all those who have recently died in the face of God, those on our pew sheet, and any others known to people personally. May their relatives and friends find comfort in their sadness and looking forward to meeting them in the afterlife. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
I will finish this intercession by reading the collect for the first day of Lent, commonly known as Ash Wednesday. Almighty and everlasting God, who hates nothing that thou hast made, and doth forgive the sins of all them that are penitent, create and make in us a new and contrite hearts, that we worthily lament our sins and acknowledge our wretchedness. May obtain for thee the God of all mercies, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Father,
accept Jesus Christ, the Savior of the Messiah, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand for the peace. Jesus Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of Christ's peace as you are comfortable doing.
Peace be with you, peace be with you, and peace be with you.
We're going to go straight on to our offertory prayer. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
All things come from you, and of your own do we give
you. The Lord is here.
His grace is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Please be seated. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children.
In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us.
In
took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and he gave it to them saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
I will do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ and in the Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, singing, sanitizer at the front here. We have communion by intinction, dipping the bread in the wine over the other side of the pulpit, by the common cup up at the communion rail. If you're coming up to the communion rail, you don't need to queue for the Trinity position. If you wish to come up but not take communion, if you just cross your hands like so, and we'll know to pray with you. In your seat, that's fine too. For those of you who wish, I will come to you and bring communion. And now, draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and drink his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith. Let us pray. Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we who are partakers at his table reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and to save. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together, Father and Lord, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, give you credit for your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of your glory. May we share Christ's body, live his prison life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit guides give life to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And our final hymn is Jesus Be the Center. Your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always.
Amen.
Please be seated. We have a few notices. First, about the ecumenical Lent groups. They've all been decided, and we've got one group Tuesday mornings at the Methodist Church. There's a Zoom Tuesday afternoon meeting. There's a Tuesday evening meeting in Pound Meadow, a Thursday evening meeting in Pound Meadow, and a Saturday morning meeting in the parish room of the Roman Catholic Church. There's a poster like this in the hall porch, so if you are already signed up, you can see where it is you're going, and if you're not and you're interested, you can see who's leading it and to get in touch with the relevant leaders. Now, this Tuesday, there's a bit of a competition. I'm sorry, but I think Joan is going to lose out, because this Tuesday is Shrove Tuesday, and we have our pancake party at 6:30, which we've got going on thanks to Vanessa and
Lucy, oh, come on now, Keith.
Who are organising and running it. It's been our tradition that the men flip the pancakes. So men, please come armed with a pancake pan. The rest will be there, but I think Lucy's going to say something about it now. That's at 6:30 in St Catherine's Hall.
Yeah, we're going ahead with the pancake party. We do need cookers, so if, as Keith has just said, men could come forward. Vanessa and I are organising it. I have got all the pancake mix and stuff. What we will say is we will provide water, but if you want to bring a drink, please do so. And that's it. So I hope you will come and support us. Thank you.
And there will be a quiz, which may be easy or may be make the Times crossword look like a piece of cake. Come along and find it. Andrew.
I wouldn't recommend eating on the Times crossword. In 1 month's time, on March 21st, the contractors arrive to install the new lighting in the chapter house. Before you have a chance for them, it's at the chapter house. Which gives all of you who have any stuff, and there's quite a lot of stuff, in the chapter house, 1 month in which to move it. The contractors have agreed that the furniture that's in there can be piled up in the centre of the room, but knowing what's in some of that furniture, it's going to have to be emptied before we can move the furniture, although you can then put the stuff back in. But quite a lot of the material that's in there is going to have to leave the chapter house altogether for the duration, which will be, well, the installation will take 1 week, but we're allowing a second for snagging just in case. Okay, so please think what's in there and get rid of it. Thank you.
Thank you. We've got Kate, and before Kate comes on, just want to say Ash Wednesday is this Wednesday, obviously, day after Shrove Tuesday. We've got two services, one at midday and one at 7:15. The midday service will be followed by soup and a roll in the chapter house, and on Wednesday both services will take place in the chancel. So come along for that. Kate.
Hi everyone. Three brief invitations from me today. This afternoon we have an absolutely beautiful choral evensong in this church at 5:30. You get to sing traditional hymns out of an actual hymn book as well. So please do come along if you like that sort of thing. Secondly, on Saturday the 4th of March, that's in 2 weekends' time, we're having an organ recital. A gentleman from Paris is coming to St. Michael's. He is both an organist in a parish church and an astrophysicist at the Paris Observatory, and I believe a Chevalier of the Légion d'Honneur, if that's how you pronounce it. He will talk about his interest in the stars and about the music that he's playing, which is inspired by the heavens and the celestial bodies. My request or invitation to you, however, is also I would love one or two people to offer to bake cakes, either a cake or a plate of small cakes for this recital. They are sociable events. We hold them on a Saturday morning, and all the donations that we get from them go towards the church, so it's in a really good cause. Thank you. And lastly, Those of you who are regulars know that we have a small church choir who sing here twice a month at the 10 a.m. service. We seem to be having a soprano crisis at the moment, in that we don't have quite as many ladies coming forward to sing the top line as we would like. Lots of harmony singers, I beg your pardon. But if you could help or know someone who could sing soprano, please do come get in touch with me. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And whilst by no means least, Ian.
We seem to have got quite a few people offering soup at the moment, both at the service after the service, and I'd like you to come to the Lent lunches, which have been held as usual in aid of the mission in Matwara, where we've been supporting this for many years, and this is our main contribution. The first one is on Wednesday the 1st at our house in Browning Road. Anybody who don't know where that is, contact me afterwards. Then on the 10th in St. Catherine's Hall, and on the 23rd with Francis and Richard Nightingale. So any doubt, come and ask me where these places are, and please come along for Lent for soup and roll and other goodies at that time. And I'd like to also, if I may, Keith, mention that Stephen and Gillian Chowns are here today because the Methodist Church unfortunately had to close because there's quite a few members have got COVID. Should you wish to talk about the Lent groups, they are more au fait with it than I am, and they will no doubt be staying for coffee.
Thank you. Oh, well, I'd spotted you here, and I didn't realise it was for such onerous reasons. Let's pray for the Methodists. Heavenly Father, we are saddened to hear that they've not been able to meet because of COVID. We pray that it will not be affecting those who caught it. Unduly, may it just be a light touch for them and they will be healed soon. And we pray, Lord, that you will watch over them and bless them and draw them closer to you. Amen. And now, would you please stand? Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.